Vacations are not the best. I just prefer to sit or lay on my ass all day playing with electronics. Just saying. Also, to put it bluntly, Far From Home is still not as good as the Sam Raimi trilogy, nor the two amazing Spider-Man films. Granted, the film did a few things better, but at the same time, it did a few things worse as well. It still has stupid romantic comedy cliches, some of the characters are idiots, unnecessary pointless plot points, and Mysterio being the good guy in the trailers, yeah, I'm pretty sure you can predict what's gonna happen. And if you don't, you're stupid! So it opens with motherfucking Nick Fury and Maria Hill investigating a disturbance when Mysterio shows up and fights the monster. Then we cut to school showing pics of the dead Avengers while playing a song that reminds me of the Nostalgia Critic's review of The Room. We then get retread number 1 from Homecoming of Peter Wanted to Date a Girl, this time with MJ. It's not Mary Jane, BTW, it's Michelle Jones. Look up the wiki.
She's awesome, she's super funny in a kind of dark way.
The only personality I get from Michelle is that she's a deadpan smartass Parker. There's nothing dorky and awesome I get from her in Homecoming. Funny on the other hand, it turns out that they are going on a science trip outside of the US. Okay, how the hell does that work exactly? I never heard of a field trip where you travel to another country. Well, okay, back in middle school, after the national archery tournament? I did archery from 5th to 10th grade back then. I could recall that we could have traveled somewhere else for another archery tournament, but the issue is the money, so we could have gone, but we canceled it. And another field trip that I never wanted to go to, by the way, we could have gone to a museum, a special museum or something, and we have to ride a bus, and we have to sleep somewhere for a day or two. But having to travel to another country? Did anybody ever travel to another country in a field trip? Please leave that down in the comments below if you have any experiences. Nighttime, Spider-Man attends to a homeless shelter charity with Aunt May, which begs the question, how did she set all of this up? And Spider-Man, even though in the comics he's a confident, cocky, smart Alex superhero spewing one-liners left and right, and Tom Holland visited the children in the hospitals, seems to have a little bit of stage fright and attempts to hide his weak-ass voice.
Thank you, Ms. Parker, for having me, and thank you, you guys, for having me.
A comic book hero, everybody!
The very generous Pepper Potts said to sorry she couldn't be here.
Maybe because her actress won't return to play her role ever again. No, I'm not even joking. So Nick Fury tries to call Peter many times but always never answers and never bothers to bring the costume intentionally because Peter Parker, the amazing Spider-Man who often fights crime because great power comes great responsibility, just wants to take a vacation. Getting the girl, I understand, but having to take a vacation doesn't feel very Spidey to me. So, these two cartoons, which people are not huge fans of, has Spider-Man take vacations, but when MCU Spider-Man takes a vacation, oh, it's automatically good! It's an MCU because it's automatically good! It's totally fine. It's totally faithful. Totally very great power, great responsibility, like. By the way, I don't hate those two shows. It's just it's underwhelming and the animation is the best.
Hungry? So what's up?
You can dodge bullets but not bananas?
Huh. We actually get to the Spider-Sense issue? I mean, there was one shot in Civil War where he clearly did have the Spider-Sense, but aside from that, we finally get to the Spider-Sense? Apparently in this version, the Spider-Sense does work, it's just that he needs to focus on it. I'm not gonna lie, that's actually a pretty good change. Not bad. We never see him in that suit again for the rest of the movie, by the way. Are you pleasantly disappointed? Also, a bit of a nitpick, but wouldn't that result in a huge electric bill? So Parker heads off to the airplane, tries to sit next to MJ but fails. We have a stupid sex joke in the bathroom, and Ned gains a girlfriend all the way because the two touched hands.
We actually got to talking on the plane, and it turns out we have a lot in common.
I wonder which chemistry this was. This or Resident Evil 2 with Ada and Leon? But the dog smells something in Parker's bag and...
Please no.
Okay, did the MCU become a stupid cartoon when it comes to Spider-Man? Spider-Man is basically right in front of you, woman! Well, they finally make it to Vince and settle in while a couple of copyrighted songs play. And of course, Peter tries to get the girl like it's a stupid romantic comedy. Okay, guys, can we please stop with the romantic bullshit where Peter wants to date someone but has trouble doing so? I swear, that dumbass subplot is in every single Spidey film to date. Is Sony running out of ideas or something? We do finally get another action scene where the water monster is rampaging throughout Vince. Okay, what was going through your mind there? You just shot your webs at a water monster and hope it'll be extremely effective? I thought you were a smart-ass science boy! He does pick up a cheap mask, which at least isn't a small-ass domino mask, but he's still wearing the same clothes, so he's still pretty much risking getting recognized! Mysterio shows up and has Spider-Man help the civilians, and then we end up with a cartoon moment with Peter slamming his head against the bell a couple times, and yet somehow doesn't get knocked out and let go of the webs. Mysterio destroys the water creature, and we get a running joke of the movie that's admittedly pretty funny. The first time, anyway.
What do you think it is?
You know, being a man of science, witches.
What is it with you and Spider-Man?
He's just awesome, okay?
Funny, considering that he destroyed your father's car. But it's okay, all is forgiven.
He protects the neighborhood and, you know, he's inspiring.
That and I have a Stockholm syndrome.
So Nick shows up, and I gotta say, the idea of Samuel Jackson with Spider-Man is an awesome idea on paper, but unfortunately, it's somehow underwhelming in the final cut.
A week ago, a village in Mexico, a village was-
Okay, I'm not gonna lie because this scene is actually pretty funny, but can't you just leave and then explain the situation?
With dangerous bacteria,
another person touches that door, you and I are going to attend another funeral.
That's a bit out of character to kill an innocent, guys. And also, in a millisecond after, he tells Parker to suit up and to leave. I think this scene was rushed.
Stark left these for you. Uneasy lies the head that wears the crown. Stark said you wouldn't get that because it's not a Star Wars reference.
Kinda funny, considering that Mace Windu is played by the same guy. But apparently not many people thought the prequel trilogy is very good, so erase that bitch out of existence in this universe, I suppose. Anyway, Mysterio is actually from a different Earth, and that the elemental monsters have destroyed it, and he's the last survivor.
How does that even work with all the quantum? It's insane.
Sorry. It's really cool.
You know, as much as I love Spider-Man and the fact that he's in the MCU crossing over with the Avengers and live action, Tom Holland just feels quiet and awkward sometimes. Tobey Maguire can be awkward and quiet too, but you can sympathize with him and the tough shit he's been going through trying to be a good superhero. Tom Holland just feels like a pussy! He's 100% fine with going on vacations, he's wanting to become an Avenger because it's awesome, he's way too focused on getting the girl, asked to borrow a car for a science project because his invention is somehow inferior, and there's none of that great power comes great responsibility vibe I'm getting from this Spider-Man. I get it, he's a teenager, but every single teenage spider I've seen, he does at least focus on being a good superhero, while this Spidey feels like he just prefers to be a hero when he's not busy with, well, doing every teenage stuff ever! Also, he's not imposing in the slightest. Not only is he short, but he is not a cocky smartass like Andrew Garfield, and the way he talks is just stiff. He's like the reboot Ratchet from Ratchet & Clank 2016, a bad insulting game! But, at least it isn't Into the Spider-Verse! I will never stop making fun and hating the movie. Peter tells Fury he can't join because the students and teachers might put the two and two together with Spider-Man and Peter, and Fury just lets him go? Dude! Just make an excuse that Spider-Man is working with Nick Fury to go around the planet saving the world. It's a simple but effective excuse. So that way we won't have to end up with one of the most disturbing, awkward things ever, which we'll get onto in a minute. Oh, God. Nick decides to hijack the vacation and everybody gets on the bus to Prague. And oh look, the sniper rifle guy is the bus driver, and he's just simply ignoring people talking to him like he's the Queen's guard. Okay. I am convinced that the MCU has become a cartoon. And not in a good way. And yes, I know that bus driver slash sniper rifle guy has the name, but he contributes nothing aside from being the bus driver telling people to... Oh no, not this scene. Okay, at this point, if you watched my other reviews, you probably think I have a bad taste or I'm made out of stone because I do not find the jokes in other movies and games funny. But not only is this also unfunny and awkward, it is just uncomfortable. Some female agents got a suit for Parker to wear so nobody can suspect Spider-Man and Peter being in the same place. That alone I don't exactly have a problem with. But she's telling Peter to undress and get changed immediately, and there's not a changing room or bathroom for him to change in! She expects him to dress up right on the spot! Is she a pedophile? Just let him change in private! Who wrote this scene? Not only is it played stupid, but it's also just disturbing! Oh, and of course, we have a stupid-ass misunderstanding. Is there no lock on that door? Oh, and we have another dragged-out scene where the admittedly pretty cool sunglasses is an AI named Edith putting out a drone because Parker accidentally has this asshole a target for termination. He stops the drone and has Edith delete the photo. And I'm not gonna lie, at first when I watched it in theaters, I was confused at how the picture was deleted, but it turns out Parker has Edith delete the photo, so it's probably another one of those blink and you'll miss type things, but whatever, it's still a stupid, pointless scene. They settle in Prague and Parker meets up with Nick Fury and Quentin Beck once again.
Stark gave you multi-billion-dollar AR tactical intelligence system, and the first thing you do with it is try and blow up your friends. It's clear to me that you were not ready for this.
Then why are you still letting him tag along then? I know the world is in danger, but Tony in Homecoming just takes away his suit for legitimate reasons. But apparently you're fine with heroes tagging along and to potentially die. And for those of you who are saying it's because other heroes aren't available, allow me to replay the clip and point out a little something.
What about Thor?
Off world.
Okay, Doctor Strange.
Unavailable.
Captain Marvel.
Don't invoke her name.
Hawkeye, Black Panther, Winter Soldier, Falcon, Hulk, and Wanda Maximoff. There are other heroes to go around that are the Avengers, you know.
It's a hard path. You see things, you do things, you make choices. People look up to you. And even if you win a battle, sometimes they die. I like you, Peter. You're a good kid.
Can these guys make it any more obvious that Mysterio is just a villain in disguise trying to make himself look good? I know he claims he's from a different universe, but it's pretty obvious that he could just be faking it, and Mysterio is one of the main villains in Spider-Man in the comics, so it's pretty obvious he's gonna be the bad guy later on. And people say the MCU always makes good movies, even though some people are pussies for not admitting that they have flaws and that there's one or two movies they don't enjoy. I don't care if it's illegal in 47 states to hate or dislike one single MCU movie. Just nut up, you cowards! I mean, this movie's alright, it just has problems up the ass! So after more forgettable teenage scenes, we finally get another action movie, this time with the Lava Man. Or Molten Man, who cares.
No, come back! Come back and help us!
I'm acting! Acting! Very badly! But while this is happening, we have another stupid scene with Ned covering up that Spider-Man is Night Monkey, which she completely buys even though monkeys don't fire webs. And Spider-Man ripped off a piece from some invisible object, which MJ noticed. They defeat the monster, and Nick Fury, even though Spider-Man can barely do shit to defeat the monster, acts like a teacher scolding him because he has a D in the class. So Quentin Beck and Peter goes to the bar, still wearing their costumes and no one bats an eye for some reason, and Peter confesses he wants to embrace the dumbass teenage romantic cliches. So he gives the either glasses to Beck. And of course, as I predicted, Mysterio is just an asshat. He's basically setting things up just to put on a good show, and one of the guys was just some guy who got yelled at by Jeff Bridges in the first Iron Man movie. However, there's a bit more to it than that. One, he's actually trying to make himself look good and doesn't have any intentions of killing Spider-Man, for the first time around anyway. Two, even though he's basically created because of Tony Stark's actions, unlike the Vulture where Tony is a dick, Stark claims that Beck is unstable, and considering the fact that a few people actually dies in previous scenes, I can't really blame Tony. So the trip is finally over as they're planning to get back home the next day, so Peter finally tries to confess his love.
MJ,
I'm Spider-Man.
What?
I mean, I've been watching you for like a while now. It's kind of obvious.
She actually knows he's Spider-Man? I gotta give this movie credit. It's actually kind of refreshing.
And the news never lies.
CNN and Fox, you two. MJ grabs out a piece of tech covered in webs, and it turns on to reveal the whole thing was just a show, causing Peter to admit he's Spider-Man.
I was only like 67% sure. I can't believe I figured it out.
Oh, she was joking around for about 50% of the time and guessed right? That's kind of disappointing. But I will say that it's good that MJ is actually showing bits of emotions after being a deadpan snarker for so long. But Beck is onto Peter as he discovers what he and MJ discovered. So of course, he tries to kill Peter, who tries to tell Nick Fury, and this illusion scene is pretty cool.
I don't think you know what's real, Peter.
Peter?
I created Mysterio to give the world someone to believe.
Nick shows up just in time, but again, it's just an illusion to get him to tell Beck of who also knows of the illusion tech. The train goes by and Peter passes out inside the train. He then wakes up in a prison of the Netherlands with the nicest prisoners ever.
We gave you the shirt because you seemed a bit cold.
He escapes and the people are also nice enough to let him borrow a phone to call Happy for help. I think us Americans need to take notes of the Netherlands. Happy shows up to pick up Peter and patch him up. And I gotta say, I actually like that Happy and Peter have a good relationship. In the last film, Happy is just kind of a dick, but because Spider-Man saved his job, it's all good. Anyway, Peter blames himself for the whole mess and how he could not be the next Iron Man. I do like this scene, mostly because we can feel Peter's pain and guilt, and the acting is solid, and Happy inspiring Peter also helps. They find out that the students and teachers are in London and head over while Spider-Man develops his new suit, which is just the same suit, just replaced blue with black. He could be using his Iron Spider suit, I'm just saying.
I like the new suit.
Thanks.
It will never be as cool as the Symbiote Black suit nor the Sam Raimi suit. The two arrive just in time as the fake elemental monster starts wrecking shit as Peter's friends and teachers fight for their lives. Spider-Man gets inside the hologram and begins ruining the act. The climax is pretty cool and intense. Mysterio drops the illusion act and has the drones try to kill Spider-Man and the kids, while Happy tries to protect Peter's friends.
I wasted my life playing video games.
I have a fake ID, and I've never even used it.
I post stupid videos daily.
I'm in love with Spider-Man's aunt.
Okay, as stupid and cartoony this is for them to ignore the dangers to look at Happy weirdly, this is still pretty funny, I must admit. Spider-Man and Mysterio square down as he uses his spider sense to avoid the drone attacks. Mysterio accidentally gets shot in the process and dies after Spider-Man manages to take Edith back and stops the drone attack. So everything is fine and dandy once more. Peter and MJ hook up, Happy acts tough in front of Fury, Ned and some chick broke up but are in good terms with each other, May and Happy don't know if they're dating or not, and MJ is scared when it comes to swinging with Spider-Man, which is unlike the first Sam Raimi Spider-Man movie at all. Because that's what this is all about. Oh, wait, hold on. We got a mid-credits scene. And also a cameo for the asshat J. Jonah Jameson. Oh good, I wonder what new actor they got to play for this role.
That's
No way. They did not. They got the actor, J.K. Simmons, the guy who played J. Jonah Jameson in the Sam Raimi Spider-Man trilogy, to return to play the character once again for this movie. They got J.K. Simmons to return as J. Jonah Jameson! Oh my gosh! It's like, they know no one's gonna compare, so they decide to say fuck it and bring it back. Wow! Just wow! That actually brings a huge smile to my face. Disney or Sony, whoever's responsible for this, thank you very much. I mean, I don't usually like J. Jonah Jameson sometimes, but for this, I'm actually very happy that J.K. Simmons returns. Thank you. Just thank you. Before Mysterio died, he actually recorded himself and exposed his Spider-Man's secret identity.
What the
Holy crap, first Aunt May finding out his identity, and now his secret identity gets exposed to the public? Disney and Sony, you're onto something, I just know it. It better be a good something. Then of course we get the traditional post-credits scene where we get the biggest twist of the entire movie. These two isn't Nick Fury and Maria Hill, they're the Skrulls from Captain Marvel. The real Fury is just chilling out in the hologram in space. Oh, of course! It all makes perfect sense now! Maybe the woman who is asking Peter to change immediately in that stupid ass scene earlier is a teenage girl in disguise and she's a pervert! That's still awkward and disturbing nonetheless! Anyway, that was Far From Home, and it was... meh. What it did better is that the villain, while forgettable, is better written to the point where I can't really blame the hero, Tony Stark. The Spider-Sense is finally acknowledged and has a legitimate explanation and change that works fine in this version of Spider-Man. Happy and Peter has a good bond. It's refreshing that May knows his secret. And of course, J.K. Simmons returning. But what it did was, is that some of the jokes still don't really work that well, the writing needs more polish, the film and even Spider-Man himself still has stupid teenage stereotypes and cliches, some characters are morons, there are forgettable moments and action scenes aside from the climax, and don't get me started on this scene! The film still suffers issues and can be pretty stupid. I can understand what the MCU is delivering to the table with Spidey, but I'm not that big of a fan. As someone who enjoys Spider-Man, I wouldn't rush out to go see this movie anytime soon. You're probably better off just renting it just like Homecoming.